It started.
If you step that way, they won't be able to see the word.
Yeah, I know that.
And if you go like this.
Okay, so my wife's kind of my coach. She looked at last week's video and just burst out laughing, so I knew it had to be good. I knew it had to be good. Okay, today we're going to talk about a difficult subject, and so we're going to pray again before we do it. But we're going to talk about suffering and how to suffer well. One of the things that early Christians were known for, believe it or not, one of the reasons the gospel spread well in the early centuries is that Christians died very well. They died well. And they would go out and be burnt. They would be fed to lions. And some new modern scholars try to say, well, that didn't really happen. But I believe the historical record is it did really happen. So you probably didn't need to know that. But, you know, people always try to say, you know, Jesus didn't really live and Moses wasn't real and David didn't happen. And they try to say all these things. And then, you know, they 100 years later, they dig up something and find out it really did happen. So we believe the Bible, and I also happen to believe, you know, some of the early accounts that came of Christians who shared their faith in the early Roman Empire and were put in arenas and were fed to lions and were, like the book of Hebrews says, people were, you know, cut in two with swords and they were starved, they were imprisoned, and they did it well. And you can recall the account of the Apostle Paul going into prison. And he did it well, you know. He would be flogged, he would be beaten, and then what would he be doing later on in the day? Yeah, he'd be singing, okay? He'd be singing hymns. I believe this is part of the gospel of Jesus Christ that particularly in the West, in Western Christianity, mostly in what I might say the prosperous Christianity, we have neglected this teaching. And I failed to understand that following Jesus, part of the resource that he gives us is the ability to suffer well. Now, how does he do that? We're going to look today at Jesus going into the desert for 40 days. And he wasn't just on a spiritual retreat. He was suffering. He didn't eat for 40 days. He didn't get to talk to anybody for 40 days. For some of us, that would kill us, right? Being alone that long, not being able to talk to anybody, being hungry. It didn't say he had a Winnebago with him. It didn't even say he had a tent with him. He was maybe even cold and at night hungry. You know, I don't know if you've ever gone 40 days without eating, but you actually get permanently cold. You're permanently cold. How many of you like to come home to a cold house? Yeah, well, some of us do. Some guys that run hot, you know. But to be cold, to be hungry, to be alone, you know, is to really to be vulnerable to the elements. Many of us take a lot of precautions. Well, hello. Now we're having, this is the stage lights. A lot of us take precautions that we don't ever get hungry. We don't ever get cold. We don't like to get wet. We don't like to be alone. We don't ever like to be quiet. In other words, like to have somebody to talk to. Or we like to have somebody talking to us all the time. Just imagine if you had to turn your TV off for 40 days and your radio off. And, you know, like there's no entertainment in the desert, you know. So I'm trying to tell you this a little bit just to prepare you to think Jesus wasn't just going to a well-equipped monastery in the desert to hang out with monks for a month, you know. Actually, 40 days is a little longer than a month. He was being led by the Holy Spirit into suffering, okay? So everybody, I want everybody to say the word suffer. One, two, three. Suffer! Okay, that's what Jesus was doing. He was suffering. Now remember, last week was the baptism of Jesus. And something really, really important happened at the baptism of Jesus. And the Father spoke to the Son and said, "This is the Son whom I love." A voice from heaven. "This is the Son whom I love." What was happening at the baptism is the Father and the Son were connecting in a covenantal way in front of everybody, saying, "We are one." And we're going to live this life out together. I know the Father loves me, and the Father is saying he loves me, and that is settled. I know the Father loves me. Right? Now, Jesus, immediately after he knows the Father loves him, the Holy Spirit comes upon him. By the way, my theology and of the Holy Spirit is related to, mostly, I take it from Jonathan Edwards, who was a Puritan ancestor, the first president of Princeton University. During the time when you had to be a pastor to be the president of a university, I like to say that at least once a month. And now if you're a pastor, they wouldn't let you be a president of a university. But it was quite different in the beginning of our country. People actually did believe with all their hearts that this was a country founded by God and a Christian country and founded on the Bible. And the Congress wanted pastors to be trained to educate our nation because they believed that without a moral nation, you cannot have a democracy. It will slowly deteriorate into a dictatorship. So, or a king, which is a dictator, kind of. So, Jesus was full of the Holy Spirit. Now, the Holy Spirit, Jonathan Edwards taught this doctrine of the Trinity, and he was a good Puritan, Protestant, Reformation, Puritan. He believed that the Holy Spirit was the third person of the Trinity that came from the love that the Father and the Son had for each other. So the Father loves the Son loves the Father. It's so powerful that actually the third person of the Trinity, actually they call, there's technical language for all this so you don't say anything wrong. The Holy Spirit spirates out of the love between the Father and the Son, and actually is the third person of the Trinity. So when the Holy Spirit comes upon us, what do we feel? We are filled with the love of God. Paul says this in Romans 5:5. Love does not, hope does not disappoint us. For the love of God is poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit. That's Romans 5:5. That's good doctrine, good Bible, good theology. Believe it. And any of you that have ever come up here that have been deeply troubled and hurting, and the Holy Spirit comes on you, what happens to you? You have a revelation that God loves you and that he is here for you. And that changes everything. It changes everything. And so that the suffering you go through, whether it's your physical pain or financial or relational or spiritual, whatever you've got going on that's disturbing you, when the love of God is poured out upon you, your heart is filled with hope and you can keep on keeping on. It gives you a whole new perspective for the suffering that you're going through. So before Jesus goes out into suffering, he has to go to the baptism first, because baptism is where his relationship with the Father and the Son is solid. And so he walks out into the desert. In verse 1 of Luke chapter 4, it says, Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, left the Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness. So this is really going to seem weird, but basically Jesus is absolutely bubbling over with the love of his Father and his love back to the Father, which really is the Holy Spirit, is the essence of all that love that's going on. And where does this love say go? To the wilderness. Why? Because true love, now listen to me now, true love has to be tested. Everybody's in love on their honeymoon, right? Everybody's generally, unless it was our honeymoon, but that's another story. We had a lot of trouble on our honeymoon. I had a lot of repair that needed to happen to me. And anyway, that's another story. Everybody generally is in love in their honeymoon. But when does your love get tested? When there's trouble? When you have financial trouble? When you have health issues, you know, when you have relational issues, when you have communication issues and the issues of needing to forgive each other, that's when your love is tested. So the very first thing that's going to happen to Jesus is his love is going to be tested. That might sound kind of weird to you, but remember, Jesus is a human being. Yes, we believe he is God incarnate, but as a man, as a human being, he has to overcome, and he has to overcome the temptations and trials of life that he's going to expect you and I to do. Jesus is the forerunner of our faith. He's the pioneer of our faith. He's our shepherd, and we're the sheep. And what he does, we will do. So, what does he do? He suffers. So guess what? You and I get to suffer. Okay? Yeah. Isn't that great? So Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, was led into the led by the Spirit into the wilderness. I just piled a mother load of theology on you, and I hope that if it seems confusing to you, that you can spend time seeking God and studying and trying to get a handle on this. But in God's love, Jesus is going out into the wilderness. And what's going to be tried is his relationship with his Father. In relationship to the suffering that he's going through. Okay? So let's move on. Where it says, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. Now, let's just talk about the 40 days for a minute. Who else in the history, as you read the Bible, who else for 40-something went into the wilderness? Yeah, Moses led the children of Israel into the desert, only instead of 40 days, they were there for 40 years. Okay? And we know they were there to be tested. They were there to be tested. So, Jesus is 40 days. I like to think of Jesus as the summation of all that God wanted out of Israel. Because Jesus was born of the tribe of Judah, out of Benjamin. I mean, out of the Bethlehem, the royal house of David. Jesus represented the nation of Israel. And in a sense was the people of God, only the people of God who did not fail the test, as we saw happen to the children of Israel. So for 40 days, he was tempted by the devil. He ate nothing during those days. And at the end of them, he was hungry. The devil said to him, what? If you are the Son of God. Okay. Is that clear? So what's the devil messing with? He's trying to mess with the relationship of the Father and the Son. He's trying to mess with the relationship. In order for the devil to defeat you and me, he has to get us to doubt that God loves us. And he has to get us to doubt that you really are a child of God. And that he loves you. You know, I like it when Don Allen, she's not here right now, but a lot of times at the end of the service, she'll come up to me and she'll say, you know, I am his favorite. And I love that. You know, it's like, I go, you know what? I'm his favorite. But you know, with God, we're all his favorites. And we're all, in a sense, all individually his favorites. He loves us. And your relationship with him is being challenged every day by the devil. He knows that if he can get you to doubt your relationship with the Father and the Father's commitment to you and the Son's love for you and sacrifices made for you in order for you to have a personal relationship with God, an intimate personal relationship, if the devil can tear that down and disturb that, then you will not be able to suffer well. Remember the goal now. The goal of this sermon and the goal of this teaching, the goal of this passage is that you would learn to suffer well. Does that sound like a good sermon? A lot of times we're taught the opposite of that, that God only wants you to have a great and wonderful experience in life and you should have no bad days, you know. Well, Jesus is having some bad days here. Jesus is having some bad days. If you reread the Bible, reread the New Testament, and look for the suffering of Christ, you will find it everywhere. He's suffering every day. But he doesn't act like it. He doesn't act like you and I act when we suffer. But let's see. So the devil says, if you're the Son of God, tell this stone to become bread. Now, could Jesus do that? Yeah, Jesus could easily turn stones into bread, but he wouldn't do it. Jesus answered, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone. And what's it say? But in the Old Testament, the end of that would be, but by every word or everything that comes out of the mouth of God. It actually, in the Hebrew, it just says, everything that comes out of the mouth of God. This is a quote from Deuteronomy, when Moses is reviewing with the nation of Israel all that God had done with them as they were going through the Exodus. And he's reminding them that they didn't do very well at this, that they'd actually failed. When God led Israel out into the wilderness, he told them, come out into the wilderness. I'm going to take care of you. I'm the Lord your God. I'm going to deliver you from the hand of Pharaoh and from slavery. And you're going to come out into the wilderness to worship me. And it's all going to go great. And I will make sure that I feed you. Well, the children of Israel got out there, and where was the food? You know, they were used to having, they called them the meat pots of Egypt. They were used to having some kind of a big pot full of beef or whatever, probably water buffaloes, and they were eating that. Well, out in the desert, there was no food. And they got what? They got angry. The children of Israel got angry with Moses, and they said, Moses, what have you done? Have you just brought us out here to kill us? And Moses goes, you know, no, I didn't bring you out here to kill you. I believe that the Lord, your God and my God, is going to somehow feed us. But frankly, when I look around the desert, I don't know why. I don't know how. I don't know how he's going to do it. But he's going to do it. Jesus believed that God would feed him. What the devil wants you to do is when you and I suffer times of want, when we don't have a good job or a job at all, when we don't seem like we have enough money, you know, I mean, everybody tells you how much money do you need to retire? They used to tell you you need to have $1 million in savings. Now, on the radio, they're saying that's not enough. You won't make it to your deathbed, you know. Anyway, well, what the devil wants you to do is to get into an attitude of fear and an attitude of want and an attitude of poverty. And for you to think there is not enough, there won't be enough, and there can't be enough. And then he wants you to turn your heart in anger against who? Against God. God is a good father, and he has promised to take care of us. And the devil will do everything he can to get you mad at him and angry with him and say, God, if I'm your child and you say all these scriptures in the Bible that you're going to take care of me, how come I don't have enough? And then you get a bad attitude towards the very one who is going to provide for you. And Jesus wouldn't do it. Jesus would not. Or you can just say, well, God isn't taking care of me. I guess I'm going to take care of myself. And then you begin to make plans that are ungodly plans, which is, what do people do when they say God's not taking care of them? Well, you can steal. You can lie. You can cheat. You can gamble. Do I need to make a very big list? Is there a huge list in our country of things you can do when you don't believe that God's going to take care of you? You could get 3 jobs and never come home anymore and say goodbye to your wife and children. Or if you're the wife and you have 3 or 4 kids at home, you could say goodbye to your family and go get a great job and then marry somebody else that's got a bunch of money. I don't know. There's all kinds of things that our sinful nature can say to us to go do when we quit trusting our Father to provide for us. And this is when the devil says, the Father's not taking care of you. You and I can make a plan. Just listen to the devil. You and I can make a better plan. You know, there's some other way to do it now that you don't have to be constrained by the Bible or by God's word. Quit believing that God loves you. That's a waste of time. If you're going to get anything out of life, you got to reach out and take it for yourself. Does that sound like the devil? It is. It is. Jesus wouldn't do it. The Apostle Paul says that many people have turned away from the faith because their God is their belly. Have you meditated on that one for a while? Just pray this. Lord, to what extent have I let my belly become my God? That's not a very good sermon, is it? But just ask yourself, how often do I think about food? How often do I think about drink? How often do I think about filling my mouth with what I want? And how hard do I work to make that happen? That I can have all I want. In fact, they say that Americans have so much food in their refrigerators that they throw away over 1 billion pounds of food like a month. We throw away 1 billion pounds or 1 billion tons. I can't remember the numbers, but it was beyond my imagination that we just throw in the garbage because we can't actually eat everything we buy before it rots. Well, repent. We need to repent. This is what one of the things that Jesus is doing in the desert. He is fasting. What is fasting? It's when you quit eating. Pretty simple definition. Do you have the power, by the power of the Holy Spirit, to just say, I am not going to eat blank, you know? I'm not going to eat this meal. I'm not going to eat this day. I'm not going to eat this week. Or I'm not going to eat that fat burger I want. Those are good, by the way. Anyway, don't go there. One time my son Ryan bought me this gigantic burger up in Federal Way. It was the biggest hamburger I've ever seen in my life. I totally ate the whole thing without any problem. And then I did a mistake. I went on my phone and said, how many calories were in this? I can't remember the name of it. And I looked at it and I thought, that's going to be a week of bicycling for me to get that off of me. But anyway, it was so good, I never forgot about it. Now I'm telling the opposite. My mouth is actually drooling right now. It was too good. So it was so good, I haven't eaten one since, though. But every time I drive by it, I go, whoa. You know, anyway, the devil wants you to think that you have to just cram your mouth full all the time. You do not have to. It'd be interesting. You know, I mean, I don't really know if this is a good idea or not, but you could pray about it. Just say, I want to just kind of check myself out spiritually and see if I can deny myself. Can you deny yourself? Jesus said, unless we deny ourselves and take up our cross, we can't even be his disciples. Well, the very first test for Jesus was, could he not eat? And could he still believe that his Father loved him? Now, fasting is a little bit off topic here, because the real topic isn't just fasting. It's really, do you believe God could provide for you and not follow the devil's pathway for you provided for yourself? Just always ask yourself and pray about it. Say, Lord, am I really relying on you to provide for me? Do I believe you're my provider? Or have somehow I made a false god? Because really, that's what idolatry is, really following the devil's plan. Idolatry is following the devil's plan. That's what happened to the children of Israel. When they saw that, you know, they didn't think God was going to protect them. They didn't think God was going to provide for them. What did they do? They built an idol. And it was made out of gold. It was a golden calf. And they worshipped around that idol. They hadn't discovered yet that God really would care for them. Okay, let's go to the next one. The devil led him up to a high place and showed him in an instant all the kingdoms of the world. This is kind of a crazy one, really. And he said to them, I will give you all their authority and splendor. It has been given to me, and I can give it to anyone I want. Wow. That's why Paul says that the devil is actually the god, small g, the god of this world. The devil is not telling a lie right here. I will give you all their authority and splendor. It has been given to me, and I can give it to anyone I want to. If you worship me, it will all be yours. Wow, that's kind of a temptation, huh? Jesus answered, it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only. So in Matthew, the devil, he says it three times to Jesus, if you are the Son of God, do this. If you are the Son of God, do this. If you are the Son of God, do this. So here's a question of authority and power and control. Okay? This is the temptation. Jesus, I'm going to give you the opportunity right now, instead of living your life in the way that it's going to happen, which is you are going to be the victim of people that are in power and authority and control over your life are going to take you and kill you. That's what's going to happen. The devil's telling Jesus, I can solve that for you right now. That doesn't have to happen. I can help you set up your life in such a way that you will be the one in charge. You will be in control, and you will not have to suffer under the power and the authority of others. A lot of people in our country right now think they're going to suffer because the new authority is in Washington, D.C. A lot of people are celebrating because the old authority is out. A new authority is in. No different today than it was then. There was a lot of people in authority in Israel. There was the Romans. There was the Roman Empire. And there was the kind of false Jewish leadership that Herod appointed. It wasn't really even godly or even biblical. It wasn't even according to Scripture. And these people actually had genuine, horrible authority over the people. And these authority figures, it wasn't just the general population of Israel. It was authority figures in Israel that took over Jesus' life and crucified him. And they made his life tough all along. Jesus said, even the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. You think Jesus had a good job? He didn't have a good job. Jesus didn't have a good house. Jesus didn't have it all set up for retirement. He didn't. And we're his followers. Why do we live such a different kind of life from him? It's kind of baffling to me. The devil says, I will give you all their authority and splendor that's been given to me, and I can give it to anyone who wants. If you worship me, it will be yours. Yeah, there's only one price to having complete control over your life. What's the price? You have to worship a false god. And this is what idolatry is. Idolatry is worshiping false gods. In this case, it's the god, it's the false god of all those false gods, is the devil. He's the one that set them all up. Many of us, because of different experiences we've had in our life, have experienced intense sufferings and wants. Some of us have been abused. Some of us neglected. Some of us have been hurt because of prejudice or broken promises, broken relationships, love that went wrong, marriages that went wrong, churches that went wrong. You wouldn't believe how many people throughout my lifetime that I've prayed for that have had horrible pastors and horrible churches, cults, and just horrible, nasty things that have happened. Sexual immorality in the church, financial theft in the church. Just, I mean, it's horrible. But, you know, these things happen, and then they happen to us, and we're there, and we experience in them, and then what do? The number one thing most people do when they suffer is make a promise to themselves that what? I am not going to let that happen to me again. Well, guess what? You just bowed down to a false god. There's only one person that will promise you that, and that's the devil. God will never promise you you will not have to suffer again in this lifetime. He doesn't do that. Oh, isn't that a horrible gospel? That's a terrible message, isn't it? He will not promise that. He does not promise that anywhere. What he says is that you will have tribulation in this world, but be of good cheer. I've overcome it. And then he says, I will never leave you or forsake you. I am with you always, even to the end of the age. So what was Jesus doing every time the devil would tempt him? He would come back to his relationship with his father, and he would say, no, I am not listening to you, devil. You can promise me all the wealth and all the power and all the control, all the splendor of the nations. You could give me all the awards that Hollywood has to offer, all the power that Wall Street could give me in money, and all the wealth of Wall Street, all the power of Washington, D.C. You know what? That's not the life I'm seeking. I'm seeking my love, the love that I have between the Father and Son. I want to do his will. To me, real wealth is living in his kingdom. And real power is living under his power and his authority. And real security is his security. And if I have to eat manna for 40 years, I'm going to like that better than all the steaks that Egypt could give me. Why? Because it's who I'm going to eat my meal with. You know, just think about it. Have you ever been invited? Some friends of ours, they're invited to a very expensive dinner over the holidays. They had to spend over $300, I think it was a piece, for their meal in downtown Seattle. And I saw them afterwards. I go, was that fun? And they go, no. It was so expensive, we couldn't enjoy it. And the people we were with really weren't, they were more into how elegant everything was. They really weren't into our relationship. The conversation really wasn't good. You know, I'm going, and they said, we could have gone to Hawaii for a week on what we just spent for dinner, you know. Well, just think about it. The devil offers you that kind of dinner. The devil will offer you the greatest looking dinner, the best environment, the nicest, you know, woodwork on the walls and the paintings and the beautiful china. He's going to offer you the best. And the best meal, the best prime rib. You're going to get hungry now. And anyway, he's going to offer you the best meal that he could offer you. But you know what? The conversation is going to be really poor. Not going to give you any eye contact. Not going to say, appreciate you. He's not going to say, well done, good and faithful servant. He's going to give you what looks like a great meal. But when you walk out of that meal with the devil, you're going to be empty and you're going to regret it and you're going to wish for the rest of your life you would have gone to meal with the person that says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone opens the door, I will come into them and I will have a meal with them. And then you come out of that meal, like it says in Psalm 23, you set a table before me in the presence of my enemies. And then you say, in your presence is fullness of joy, and at your right hand are pleasures forevermore. I will never trade the meal I get to have with Jesus for all the feasts that the devil can set before me. And this is what Jesus is doing this. Jesus is going through this. After not eating for 40 days, he says no to the meal the devil wants to have, and he says no to the control he could have over his life if he followed the devil. He says, I'm not going to do that. If people hurt me, I am not going to say, that'll never happen to me again. I'll say, bring it on. Me and Jesus, we can deal with it. If Jesus could go through life and suffer rejection and hurt and abuse and be flogged and beaten and bloodied and hated and killed, then who am I to say, I deserve better? And I'm going to take control over my life so I don't get to suffer anymore. I don't have to suffer anymore. You know, that is not our goal. Our goal is to spread the love of Jesus and to bring the love of Jesus to others. And when we get hurt, yeah, we suffer. We know you suffer. Some of us in here have suffered way more than we will ever suffer. But when we all do suffer, and when we suffer, what do you do with it? How do you hold suffering? How do you handle suffering? How do you live through suffering and do it well? Jesus says, I will worship the Lord God and serve him only. Next, the devil led Jesus up to Jerusalem, had him stand on the highest point in the temple. And he says what to him? If you're the Son of God, throw yourself down from here. First of all, it's never a good idea to do that, but anyway. He commanded his angels concerning you to guard you. The devil's quoting the Bible, quoting scriptures. They will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone. What's it feel like to have your foot strike against a stone? That hurts. They didn't have boots. These guys wear sandals. They're wearing sandals. And you're running through the wilderness, and you kick your big toe right into that big rock, and you say what? We won't say that, but that hurts, you know. Some of you know the pain of broken bodies. Some of you have had your joints replaced. Some of you live with the pain of constant arthritis. Some of you have broken toes, broken feet. Some of us in here have had rifles jammed into the side of our head and broken our skulls, still getting repaired from that. Lord, help you. is tempting Jesus. I think he's tempting him to go ahead and hurt himself, thinking that the angels are going to rescue him. What does Jesus say to him? Do not put the Lord your God to the test. Okay? And when the devil had finished his tempting, he left him until an opportune time. In other words, he was going to keep working on him. If you are the Son of God. Okay? So let's kind of review here for a second. If you're the Son of God, if God really loves you, you should never be hungry, right? Wrong. I mean, I know there's promises and I pray them and I believe them that God's going to take care of me and provide for me. But on the occasion when I'm hungry, do I shake my fist at heaven and say, why? I thought you loved me. Well, if I really know the Father loved me, I won't do that. I'll just remain in prayer and in belief that God is going to figure this out. I'll work as hard as I can, but I'm going to believe he's got something on the way. And he has never failed to do that. When I suffer because other people are in control, other people have been put into leadership who are very poor leaders, angry leaders, selfish leaders, arrogant leaders, narcissistic leaders. When leaders are put in charge of my life, or when people who can do things to me that I don't think they should be able to do, but they can for some reason, and I feel like I don't have control. When other people say things to me I don't like, do I shake my fist at God? I thought you loved me. If you love me, why do these people treat me like this? Why do I have to be in this environment? Why do I have to work for somebody like that? Do you find yourself talking like that? That is the enemy of your soul getting you to put an idol and to bow down to an idol, a false god, who promises you a world that God has not made yet. God has not made the new creation that's in Christ. It's coming. His kingdom's coming. He's not here yet. His kingdom's coming, but you and I have to live in this world, and this is a world where we will suffer. We suffer because people are in charge of our lives that shouldn't be, but they are. The devil puts people in authority, and I know the Bible says that God puts people in authority, and I want to pray for that to happen, but we just read who's in charge of the kingdoms of this world. How does this feel? Can you relate to any of this? You feel, oh God, help me. I want to live at a level higher than I've been living at. How can we do that? So this last temptation, I'm going to put a little different twist on it than maybe I have in the past, but I'm looking at this from as overcoming suffering, that Jesus was led into the wilderness to suffer. So this is a suffering that would happen because of physical suffering. I really think, just think about that. Physical suffering. When you are suffering physically, do you shake your fist at God and say, why? I thought you were going to take care of me. And here I've got this trouble. I got pain in my body. You know, aches and pains all over the place. Why? I've got a disease that doesn't seem to be getting any better. Why? Yeah, I believe God can heal. He doesn't heal everybody all the time. Jesus didn't even do that in the New Testament. He didn't. Sometimes he healed everybody, but a lot of times he would just heal one person and then walk off. God is in charge, and he's mysterious. Will I pray for you to be healed? Yeah, I'll pray like crazy for you to be healed. But I also pray that while you're suffering, whatever it is you're suffering, you will not let your heart become angry and bitter against God and turn against him. This was a temptation I think the devil was saying to Jesus. If the Father loves you, he will not let you suffer. And Jesus had to say, no, 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 the Father still loves me. And he said it all the way to the cross. Unless you take up your cross and follow Jesus, you cannot be his disciple. And yet many of us have a gospel message in our minds and that we struggle with that says, if God loves me, I will not have to be in this condition that I'm in. Well, if God loves you, who says that? Who says that to Jesus? If you're the Son of God, you shouldn't have to be hungry. If you're the Son of God, you shouldn't have to have other evil people in control over your life. If you are the Son of God, you shouldn't have to suffer physical pain in your body. Even if you threw yourself off a cliff, God would take care of you. Well, you know what? That's the devil talking. You're going to, you know, suffer. Every week, several times a week, I pray with my mom and dad and Norma Sells, and you know what? They're getting old. Yeah. They're getting old. And you know, people that are in their late 80s or mid-80s, they're suffering every day. Their bodies hurt. They don't work like they should work. Their bodies don't work the way they used to work. And you know what? They're lonely too. Everybody they know, everybody they grew up with has died. What does that feel like? You know, Jesus was also alone, by the way, in the wilderness. Do you ever get mad at God because you're alone? You feel lonely? Yeah, loneliness is part of suffering. Loneliness is part of suffering. You're lonely. Don't shake your fist at God because you're lonely. They're lonely. Their friends have died. Their families have died. Their bodies are dying. And yet every morning we reread scripture after scripture after scripture that encourages them, that gives them hope, that gives them joy. We sing hymns, we sing choruses of the scriptures, and we remember how awesome God is. And when we read that, the Spirit of God comes into that room and something changes. All of a sudden, all the aches and pains don't feel quite so bad. All the loneliness doesn't feel quite so bad. All the end of life doesn't feel quite so bad. Why? Because his presence has come. In his presence is fullness of joy. At his right hand are pleasures forevermore. In Deuteronomy 8:3, God said to Israel, why he led them into the wilderness. He said, I led you into the wilderness. This is Moses actually talking to the children of Israel. God led you. He humbled you and let you hunger. He let them hunger on purpose. And then he fed you with manna, which you did not know, nor did your fathers know, that he might make you know that man does not live by bread alone, but man lives by every word that comes from the mouth of God. When we go through hard times and we suffer, it's to build our trust and our confidence in the God who's taking care of us. When it looks like no good thing's going to come your way, and instead of you moving into unbelief and bitterness and anger and hurt in your relationship towards God and others, you stay in relationship and you see what he does. And then you have a great life. Yeah, everything doesn't work out the way you thought it was going to work out. You're not in control. Trust me, very little in your life is going to turn out the way you think it's going to turn out right now. Very, very little, if anything. But if you hang on to the one who lives in eternity and calls you into eternity and everlasting life and the hope of all the ages, if you hang on to your faith in him, he will take you to a place that you will never regret going, you'll never be ashamed of going, and you will never doubt. Yeah, you'll doubt, but you'll hang on and get through and believe that he loves you and that you're his child. You go through hard times. Let's go ahead and skip on over to the last scripture I have in Hebrews 12. In Hebrews is a great book to read to just try to understand suffering and the children of God. But therefore, since we're surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and sin which so easily which clings so closely, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. Why does it take endurance? Because of suffering. Your life is called a race, and you can run it, and you can make it to the end. Okay? You can win this race. How? You keep looking at Jesus. Verse 2, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him, what's the joy? His relationship between his Father and his Son, the Father and the Son, and his relationship with us. Jesus says we are his joy. We are his inheritance. He saw that he was going to save us and he was going to bring us into his family. And he just kept going. In his love relationship with his Father, the joy that was set before him, he was able to endure the cross and despising the shame. You don't have to say, oh, I love suffering, you know. I know I see t-shirts like that, you know, for weightlifters and people that work out a lot. They love to suffer. Well, you know what, really, you like it when it's over, but you don't actually like it when you're doing it, you know. But anyway, he despised the shame, but now he's seated at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who did what? He endured. What did he endure? He endured this suffering we're talking about today. Jesus endured suffering, and he was able to do it only by one resource. You know what the fuel of your soul is? It's joy. Joy is the fuel that can help you suffer. One time I was in the early days of charismatic movement. I was in Israel. There was a guy named Costa there who used to travel around the world, and he got people singing, and he loved to get people singing, and he would sing this song. He'd go, "The joy of the Lord is my strength." And so he'd go, "The joy of the Lord is my strength." Anybody know that one? "The joy of the Lord." So then one of the courses is, well, I'm in like Tel Aviv or somewhere. I don't know where I was, Haifa. And there was a lady, I was Haifa, and there was a lady with me. Her name was Anna Venter. She was a missionary in Israel. And she was from South Africa. Hey, there you go. Wonderful woman of God. Vic Meyer is a friend of mine from Kent. We went and spent time with her before we went to the kibbutz. And she taught us how to keep moral as young, viral young men, you know, whatever you want to call us. She taught us how to keep moral in an immoral environment. Well, so she had suffered a lot because she had three boys that were born in Israel. And her husband, who was a television, he was actually the only evangelist to ever be on the radio in Israel. He left her. He left her for a beautiful, blonde, Swedish girl that lived down in a kibbutz down in a lot. And left her alone to live up in the Galilee. And so she was suffering. And we were singing that song, and I was standing right next to her. And I noticed that she wouldn't go, ha, 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 ha. And I go, "Why aren't you going ha, 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 ha?" She goes, "Well, I don't really have a lot of ha, ha in me." You know, she says, "My joy, I can sing the joy, the Lord is my strength, but I don't see it as ha, 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 ha. The joy I have is a deeper joy that helped me endure the suffering of my life." And she did it. She did it. And she raised three beautiful sons, and she fought the fight to the end. She's a good friend of Elizabeth Sharp, who trained me in the Bible and how to say no to sin and yes to Christ. Consider him who endured from sinners such hostility. You know, I'm kind of messed up right now just because I'm so thankful that God let me be around true saints of God when I was younger, who knew how to suffer and who kept in the ministry, kept the fight of faith. Thank you, Lord. Sometimes I just remember all the people that failed, but man, it is great to remember the people that didn't. Consider him who endured from sinners such hostility against himself. This is a suffering. Jesus suffered. People didn't like him. People did not like Jesus. You think that's because Jesus brought a message of love that everybody would like him? How is that working out for you? You know, all Jesus wants to do is tell everybody that he loves them. And they don't like it. They don't like that message. Anyway, don't grow weary. Do not grow weary or faint-hearted in this fight. In your struggle against sin, you've not yet resisted to the point of shedding blood. Have you forgotten the exhortation that addresses you as sons? My son, do not regard lightly the discipline of the Lord, nor be weary when reproved by him. And this is when God actually leads you into times of difficulty because he's trying to grow you up. You know, children that are just treated all gently and kindly and never have to do any chores or any work around the house, they don't ever have to do any hard work. What do we call them? Spoiled. They're spoiled. God doesn't want spoiled kids any more than you want spoiled kids. You know, when I think of my childhood, some of the hardest things we had to do, go out into the snow in the middle of the winter. My dad had cut a tree down. They owned land over what is now the racetrack area over there. My mom's relatives all owned that area. We'd go out there, cut trees down, put them in the back of an old 49 Chevy pickup, haul it through the snow, bring it home, try to cut wood that wasn't even ready to be cut, and try to put it in the fire, get the fire going. That was a lot of work. But you know what? When we think about it, we always smile, and we always are happy we did it. But at the time, it was difficult, you know? But yeah, suffering is tough. But if you do it together, if you do it together with the Father and the Son, and I think it's good to have good friends and good faithful friends in Christ to suffer with. If you don't have anybody that you know that you can say, I'm having a tough day, then you are really alone. I mean, you can go to God, and you should go to God. He wants to walk through you. He wants to take your hand and lead you through the valley of the shadow of death. But he also wants you to have friends. Don't be weary. For the Lord disciplines the one he loves, and he chastises every son who he receives. For it is a discipline that you have endured. It is for discipline you have endured. God is treating you as his children, his sons. For what son is there whom his father does not discipline? Well, we got a lot of them in our country right now. But if you are left without discipline, in which you have all participated, then you are illegitimate children and not really sons. Besides this, we have earthly fathers who disciplined us, and we respected them. Shall we not much more be subject to the Father of spirits and live? In other words, trust that God is at work. For they disciplined us for a short time, as it seemed best to them, but he disciplined us for our good, that we may share his holiness. For the moment, all discipline seems painful rather than pleasant, but later it yields a peaceful fruit of righteousness to those who have been trained by it. Therefore, lift up your drooping hands and strengthen your weak knees and make straight paths for your feet, so that what is lame may not be put out of joint, but rather healed. Amen. Thank you, Jesus.